सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यंतां वंदे गुरु परंपरां। सो लास्ट टाइम वी सॉ दोज वर्सेस यदृच्छा लाभ संतुष्टः। आई थिंक वी स्टॉप विद दैट वर्स। ओके या ओके दैट्स व्हाई आई आस्क्ड whether it is coming right or not. Okay. How is that now? Yeah. Okay, fine. Okay. So we saw that. Any questions, clarification on the last few verses that we seen? Or is it all clear? Eighteenth we had seen earlier. 19, 20, 21, 22 we saw. Two lifestyles. How does the person who has gained knowledge function? Okay, there are no questions. Let's go forward. Okay. The topic is the same. Okay. The topic is the same for the next 2-3 verses. Yeah. The topic he started was Karmani Akarmaya Pashyet Akarmani Karmayaha. That is the main thing. Okay. One who sees himself. One who sees oneself as completely free from all karma, when you are actually doing karma, as I the consciousness, I am free from all karma. And naishkarmiyam, or freedom from karma, is not just sitting down and keeping quiet. That's an ability. We'll come to that. But this is knowledge. Okay? This is knowledge. Therefore, that was the main thing, to see yourself as free from all actions. When you say free from all actions, you are free from doing and receiving both. That means what? Free from doing and receiving means there is no guilt, there is no pain at the psychological standpoint. One of the ways that you know where you are sure about this, there is neither guilt nor pain for anything. Because guilt is with respect to I have done. Pain is with respect to what I have received. Both I am free from. Both I am free from. Okay. So that is the condition of someone who knows the truth. Then we saw how the wise that person lives, etc. All that we saw again. Okay. Nitya Truptaha Nirashaya. Okay. All that we have seen. Yadrcha Labha Santushtaha. Both we saw. Living in a sannyasi lifestyle, living in a karma yoga lifestyle. Either way, you are free from everything. Then continuing that idea, he says, Gata Sangasya Muktasya Jnana Avasthita Chetasaha Yajnaya Charataha Karma Samagram Praviniyate. Gata Sangasya Muktasya. Gata Sangasya. The person from whom all detach, all dependency is gone. Dependency for the sake of happiness, all that is gone. Don't say you are dependent because you are waiting for the lift to go up. Okay? That is not what we are talking about. Emotional dependency. Okay? For the sake of happiness. Gataha. Muktaha is free from all issues. Why? Because Jnana Avasthita Chetasa. Jnana Avasthita Chetasa. That mind is full of this knowledge. is rooted in the self knowledge. That person, yajnaya charataha karma, even though he will be doing activities for daily requirements, etc., whatever necessary he will do, says samagram praviliyate, all the karmas are gone. No more is he a victim, no more is he under the bondage of any karma. He is free. That's the idea, complete freedom. Okay, now simple verse, literally winding up that topic. Now he is using, in the next verse, he is using the Vedic Yaga. Okay, the Vedic Yaga to illustrate what it means to function in this knowledge. Okay, in a yaga there are what? There is a deity, there are offerings, invocation, all this is there. So what is all this that you see? Looking at that, he is talking about it. Okay, with all these standpoints, he is talking about what is the state of knowledge of a wise person. Okay, he says brahmarpanam brahma havihi brahmagno brahmanahutam brahmeva tena gantavyam brahma karma samadhina. Some of you will be familiar with this verse. You chant it before you eat. Okay. Now look at it. Arpana. Arpana meaning what is offered. Okay. Or the, rather the means of offering. Okay. Is a brahmeva arpanam. The ladle, etc., with which you are offering it. Brahman. That is what, nothing but Brahman. Brahma havihi. The havis that's offered, all the sticks and the this, etc. Brahmaneva. The fire that is lit, Brahmagnau. Therefore, look at it. The offering, the instrument of offering is Brahman. The havis is Brahman. Okay. The fire is Brahman. So, into the fire that is Brahman, into the fire that is Brahman, you are offering by the ladle which is Brahman, the havis which is Brahman, and who is offering it? Brahmanahutam. The one who is offering it is also Brahman. Brahmeva tena gantavyam brahma karma samadhina. And what is the end reached? Brahman eva. Brahman eva. For whom? Brahma karma samadhina. For one who is mind is always resolved, samadhina, always resolved in Brahman. It doesn't mean he is sitting in samadhi all the time. No. Okay. His mind is not away from this knowledge. Mind is not away from this knowledge. So when the mind is rooted in this knowledge, this is what happens to you. Anything that you do, the doer is Brahman, the action is Brahman, the means of action is Brahman, the result is Brahman. You mean to say you don't see anything other than Brahman? What is there other than Brahman? Look at it. He sees himself as an apparent doer, taking an apparent means, an apparent action, an apparent result. Not one of them stands independent of Brahman that I am. This is, remember one thing, this is 2 degrees of reality. One is absolute reality that I am, and the other is the apparent functional reality. It's exactly like a person saying, I am walking on a round earth. Who knows? I am walking on a round earth when the earth is appearing flat. The person who knows the round earth is not that he is not experiencing the flatness of the earth, but the flatness of the earth is an appearance. Reality is a roundness. You enjoy a sunrise, which is apparent, knowing full well the sun doesn't rise or set. Similarly, karma, karmaphala, everything apparently it is there in the world. You are doing something, you are achieving something, whatever, whatever. But really speaking, what? There is not a thing that stands apart from Brahma. Therefore, when you are eating, what is it? Brahman. Brahman is eating Brahman. Ahamannam, ahamannadau. I am both the eater and the eaten. If I am both the eater and the eaten, I am neither the eater nor the eaten. Eater and eaten are two apparent manifestations. I am nothing but pure consciousness. Therefore, I am the one who is doing. I am the action. I am the result of the action. Means what? Apparent standpoints for me, the consciousness. Apparent standpoints. So why do you chant it before eating? That is a reminding. Hey, you are eating, etc. No? Is ultimately to know this thing. Ultimately, it is to know this. So right now you can do everything. But ultimately, this is what you have to know. Therefore, it is a reminder. Three times a day you eat. And three times a day you chant it. Three times a day you are reminded, hey, this is your ultimate goal. Beautiful. Yes, one does. A question came up. Does one do rituals for the apparent self? Yeah. Two types of rituals. One right here to get result here, one hereafter. Right here, if you are doing results for getting, who wants that money? Brahman, the consciousness, or the functioning entity who wants to achieve something with that money. It's always a functioning entity, the apparent reality, not the absolute reality. And what is money? Apparent reality, na? Money is the most mithya thing in the world. Really, this thing called money, especially when it came to currency that we call today, is the most mithya thing. Why? A country is supposed to print as much of rupees. Look at it. That rupee, that 2000 rupee note is actually speaking only a promissory note that is backed by that much of gold in the government reserves. This is a gold standard. That means this note is worth so much of gold. But every day you see the prices of gold fluctuating. How can that happen? If this note the government is saying is worth so much of gold, tomorrow how come the cost of gold has gone up, my rupee value has come down? Pure mithya, no? Gold standard is pure mithya. And then once your economy becomes strong, you can de-link your monetary system from the gold standard. You have had it. Because in the next 50 years, your money is worth nothing after that. 50 years it'll last. States, USA is going through that turmoil right now. What is the worth of your money then? Pure mithya. Pure mithya. But it gets things done. Yeah, that's all. So it's a functioning, for the functioning self, you have an equally mithya stuff that you get things done with. Yeah. Then, what about things hereafter? Who is the guy who is going hereafter? Not me, the consciousness. That heaven exists in me, the consciousness. I am there. I don't have to go to heaven, I am already there. If you want me to put it mystically, as I sit here, I sit on every dimension in this universe. on every planet in this universe, I said. Correct? As consciousness, I am there. Therefore, consciousness does not have to go to heaven. Then who has to go? This functioning entity, this apparent jiva, the ahankara, the sukshma sharira, mind, body, etc. This is the entity that goes and comes. That's it. So karma for this life here or hereafter is all meant for this apparent functioning entity, the jiva, the individual. Not for me, the consciousness. Me, the consciousness is free from everything. Is this clear for everyone? Or are there any doubts? Is this clear or are there any doubts? Okay. If this is clear, I've used a few terms, but since we have not done a text like Tattva Bodha or something like that, I would like to clarify some terminology. Okay. When we say mind, we generally means that part of us which talks about emotions, doubts that keeps changing. When we say buddhi, we mean our ability to reason, gain knowledge, etc. Then there is something called chittam. Okay, something called chittam, which is nothing but memory, and ahankara, the conceptual self, the idea I have about myself, which keeps all these things together. Okay? These are four standpoints of what is inside. Four standpoints. Okay, four standpoints of what is inside here. Called Sukshma Sharira. Therefore, Sukshma Sharira, the subtle body, is made of mana, buddhi, chittam, ahankara, plus your pranas, your energy body, pancha prana. Okay, pancha prana, because this is how the one prana, the energy body, manifests in your system, in your physical system. The energy body is the link between this and your body, between a sukshma sharira and the body. Okay, what is that energy body? How does it manifest? Prana, your breathing. Apana, your excretion, etc. Okay, samana, your digestion. Vyana, your circulation. And udana. Udana is the karmic time bomb kept in your throat. The udana vayu is generally not active. Unless you are doing some special energy work to activate that for outer body experiences, etc. Because the function of the udana is to eject the sukshma sharira from your physical body when the prarabdha is over. So these five pranas are also part of sukshma sharira, because they leave the body. On death, they all leave the body. But your circulatory system, etc., is left behind. The energy that makes it possible is gone. Similarly, in Vedanta, we say we have five sense organs. Eyes, ears, nose, touch, etc., smell. The five sense organs. The physical organ is there in the body, the capacity is here in your mind, in your sukshma sharira. The capacity is in your sukshma sharira, the physical organ is here. Similarly, karmendriyas, your organs of action, hands, legs, etc. Hands, legs, sexual organ, etc., speech, all this. Okay? is physical is here, but the ability is in your sukshma sharira. So how can you say that if the hand is there, if the hand is cut off? Yes, but there is something called the kinesthetic body, which all amputees experience. In fact, if someone's hand has been amputated, very often I have seen this in hospitals. They'll say, "Nurse, my palm is scratching. I'm feeling an itch in my palm. I want to scratch it." But you don't have a palm. It's been amputated away. It's amputated from the elbow and it's gone. And the nurse, they're smart. They'll say, "Scratch it." So in that area, when you feel okay. This is the kinesthetic body that extends beyond your physical into where the arm was there. The physical arm was there. This is called your kinesthetic body. Your sukshma sharira, this is. It has not yet withdrawn because in your mind, the hand is complete. For years, you have functioned with the full hand. You know, if you learn how to handle this kinesthetic body, this energy body, this mind body that is there, you will find that without physical practice, a lot of things you can do physically. New skills you can pick up because you keep playing it in your mind, and then when you do, it's very easy. But you have to learn to harness this. So this, in a way, is how you look at the sukshma sharira. So you have the physical body, the stula sharira, which is just what you see. The sukshma sharira, which is much more complex. And you have the karana sharira, the causal body, which is nothing but the ignorance and the unconscious that you experience in deep sleep state. So when you see avidya, etc., you are referring to that. The unconscious, avyaktam, unmanifest. I thought I'll just clarify that because these terms will keep coming and I don't want you all to be confused. Is that clear? Or any questions on this? Ahankara is your sense of the self, what you think you are, your conceptual self. Every one of us has a notion of what we are, no? That notion is what we call ahankara. Sorry, you have to speak up a bit. What is that? Not really. Everything is built around I, the consciousness, including the karana sharira. When ignorance is gone, as long as prarabdha is there, your sukshma sharira, stula sharira, etc. will continue. Then, next birth is not there, yes. Okay, so just to clarify that part, otherwise it can be confusing when such terms come up. Okay. Yeah. In a way, yes, but the whole karana sharira will not disappear. In the sense, your body is not yourself, but your body doesn't disappear, no? Even though your body is not yourself, the body doesn't disappear. Similarly, the karana sharira as an upadhi will continue. Why? Because you can go to sleep. Even the wise person sleeps, though politely, out of courtesy. There is a sadhu language. When you eat, what will you say? Kaha khana kha raha. And the sadhu eats, it's called bhiksha. This is just the language, okay, the pedagogy that comes up. So after a nice Sunday lunch, the sadhu Mahatma is catching a nap. Sunday lunch, yeah. And somebody says, hey, Mahatma kidhar hai? Where is Swamiji? Samadhi mein hai. He is in meditation. Why? How can he have ignorance? There is no ignorance. He knows the truth. But thank God, ignorance as an upadhi continues so that you can catch a nap in the afternoon also. And definitely you can get a good night's sleep. Otherwise, nobody will want to know the truth. Why? Sleep gone. Just imagine if your ability to sleep is gone. First few days, you'll be very happy. Why? You can get so much work done. After that, you'll be longing to sleep. You'll try all tricks of the trade to get sleep. Oh, I don't like to take medicines. Okay, let me take a drink and try. Then, what is the US Army method for going to sleep fast in 2 minutes? It is there on the net if you want, okay? Go to YouTube, there is a video on that. And it works, because we all have learned that, okay? In my Purvashrama, I learned all that, yeah. So, all that, you can try. Why? Because sleep is important, you know? Yeah. So, as an upadhi, it will continue, thank God. Yeah. But the language is like that, you know? Okay, a very interesting question. Does the Sukshma Sharira grow old? Nope. Time affects only the physical body, not the subtle body. Not the Sukshma Sharira. Time doesn't affect your mind. There can be a mature Sukshma Sharira or an immature Sukshma Sharira. Okay. A character has not learned from any of his experiences. Immature. Or is mature. That's what we call an old soul. You know, you must have used these terms in English. Old soul. It's a young person but an old soul. Meaning what? There's a lot of maturity beyond his years that is there in the person. There's a maturity beyond the years. That's all it means. The Sukshma Sharira does not grow old. Then all of us will be very ancient. Because from beginningless time onwards, we have been taking birth after birth after birth. We should be ancient people actually. All of us should be born with a white beard and this and flowing. Thank God that doesn't happen. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Self? Is it? Okay. What do you understand by the English word ego?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the English, yeah. But the English word ego means what? Let's start with the English word because it'll be easier then. Okay. You have an exaggerated self opinion, right? Okay. You have an exaggerated self opinion. That's the meaning of the English word ego. The exaggerated self-opinion, you demand respect, etc. from people. You act as though you are the big boss. Okay. Now, supposing the negative connotations we remove, what will be left behind? A self-opinion, right? An idea that this is me. When you meet somebody, and you want to tell the person who you are, you will say a few things, correct? Generally, that's your public self, what you are happy for everyone to know. But there are certain things about you which you know, which you don't want to tell others, okay? Your private self, okay? There are certain things about yourself which others know, you don't know. His character is angry. Angry? Me? No, I don't get angry. Of course you get angry. No, I'm telling you, I just don't get angry. This is my blind spot. my hidden self, you know, my blind self. I am blind to this. But this is also part of my concept. And there are certain aspects of myself which I am still trying to know. Which self? The functioning self. So this functioning self, okay, this self which is a product of our thinking, which is purely notional. I think I am like this. That I think I am like this, that entity is called the ahankara. What to do? I am like this only. Famous English statement, no? Indian English. What to do? I am like this only. That I am like this only is what we call ahankara. Your idea of who you are, what you are. It includes whatever your idea of yourself, the whole idea of what you are, which keeps changing. It is not permanent. It keeps changing. Yeah, but it can get modified, it can get changed. Yeah, exactly. The basis for your personality is ahankara. Yes, all this is ahankara. In short, your idea of what you are, your conceptual self, your notional self. Very strong entity. Your identity. Let me use a modern term. Your identity. Including the ones that you don't want to be known as. I don't want to be known just as a mother or a father. I want to be known for myself. But you are a mother. Can't deny that. Yeah, that is true. But not just a mother. Yeah, not just a mother. Not just a housewife. Of course not. Not just a housewife. But what are you? No, I'm still searching my identity. What is it? So that's ahankara. So when the ahankara starts searching for its own content, what exactly am I? You come to Vedanta. Okay. Yeah. To know the Atma, because the ahankara is a notion. For you to have a notion or a concept, there has to be a reality. The reality is the Atma, on which this notion of ahankara is superimposed. I don't know who I am, therefore I think this is what I am. That I think this is what I am is called ahankara. This is the entity that goes about doing things in the world. Really speaking, this is the entity that comes to study Vedanta also. When the ahankara gets mature enough, then it's willing to question its own existence and its own reality, then Vedanta starts working. That's why study of Vedanta sometimes becomes a bit painful, because the teacher dismisses an idea in the class, and that idea is what you have been holding on for the last 15 years, 20 years. You get upset. You can even get angry. How can he say that? How can he be so dismissive? Sorry, part of my job. You might have been holding it for 10 lifetimes for all I know. But if it is wrong, it's wrong. You are free from that. You are much more than that. What I am trying to not put you down, I am trying to point out that you are much more than all that, into the limitless consciousness itself. So if I am dismissing an idea, it is I am dismissing that idea for you to discover what you really are. And what you are is limitless. So it is not a put down. That dismissal is not a put down. That dismissal leads to a discovery of what you really are. It's a big thing. So that dismissal becomes very, very important. But people can get hurt. And people do get hurt. Yeah. That also I see in the class. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions about this? Okay, then let's go ahead. Yeah. Shoot. Yeah. Shidabhasa is a little the chidabhasa is the ahankara before it has developed all the notions. Just the manifested consciousness is called chidabhasa. Before you have loaded it with all the notions. The I thought. Yeah. Okay, any other questions? Okay, then let's go ahead. Now, he is comparing the worship and the offerings of the Karma Yogi and the Sannyasi. Devam eva apare yajnam yoginah paryupasate brahmagnau apare yajnam yajnenaiv upajuhyati. He says apare yajnam yoginah paryupasate. The yoginah, yoginah here means karma yogis, not those who are tying their body in knots all the time. Okay, not that. That's also a part of yoga, but we are talking about the karma yogis. Okay, what do they paryupasate? Okay, devam eva apare yajna. They will invoke the Lord in some manner and worship. Swami, I am a karma yogi. I don't do any yaga. Correct. So, Krishna is mentioning the highest karma you are capable of, the Vedic Yaga. It includes all other activities. When you mention the highest, all others are included. Therefore, he says, Devam eva apare yajna yajnanaha paryupasati. Because they take an Ishvara, Ishvara arpana buddhi, prasada buddhi, etc. is there. That itself becomes a Yaga, he says. Whereas, what do the sannyasinaha, what do the people who know the truth do? He says, Brahma gnau apare yajnaha yajnenaiv upajukhyati. They offer themselves into the fire of knowledge, which is Brahman, he says. To the knowledge of Brahman, they are offering all their notions and ideas. Because the sannyasis, they don't have any means to do a yaga. What yaga will they do? They are not supposed to do also. In the sannyasa karma, they have given up all that. The right to do a yaga is given up. Therefore, what yaga will they do? Nothing. They will not do anything. Then, into the fire of knowledge, brahmagnau. Okay, brahmagnau. Upajukhyati. What do they offer? All their wrong notions, etc., etc., etc. They offer themselves. The whole ahankara is offered into the fire of knowledge. The ahankara that we talked about earlier, that ahankara is offered into the fire of knowledge. By whom? By the ahankara itself. Okay. What remains then? Pure consciousness. Satyam jnanam anantam. That's all that remains. Then those ashes are taken up and worn. Why? Because you're a function in the world, na? Now you know the symbolic meaning of applying all those ashes all over. Okay. You're picking up the ahankara back because you have to function in the world. The burnt ahankara, the negated ahankara is picked up just for the sake of functioning. Now ahankara is no more a notion about yourself. Ahankara is like a dress that you wear. Like a dress that you wear. Like when you go to work, you have an official dress. No? You put on your suit, your armor to fight the world. So similarly, when the wise person has to function, the ahankara is a dress you put on. Why? You have to function. Yeah. Okay. Then, contextually, because he's talked about the yaga, he's talking about various sadhanas, disciplines, practices to make yourself a better karma yogi. Because to be a karma yogi, some sort of bhakti has to be involved. To be able to look at what you do as a worship. This is important. We say blindly, work is worship, work is worship. Okay? But really speaking, to see that your work is worship, you have to be able to see the connection between your work and Ishvara's order. To help you see that, he is mentioning a few things. By no means is the list complete. Okay, the list is not complete by any means, because there can be so many types of things. Okay, but he is talking about how anything becomes a sadhana if you have the right attitude. Now look at this. Pick up whatever you want and do as a worship from this list. Pick up whatever you want and do as a worship. Shotradin indriyan anye samyabagno juhyati shabdadin vishyan anyah indriyagnishu juhyati. Now look at it. He is talking about two opposite standpoints here. Shotradin, shotradi indriyani, your sense organs, etc., are offered. Okay? Jukhvati are offered. My sense organ is offered. Okay? Where? What is the fire? Samyama agnam. Samyama agnishu. In the agni of master. How do you do that? Hey, I want to watch the TV. Samyamagna. Both of you. You saw one serial, na? Enough for today. In the Samyamagni, you are offering your sense organ. Hey, there is nice dessert in the fridge. I can hear it calling me. You know? Let it be there. My taste, the sense organ of taste, Samyamagni. So, like this, all my sense organs, I learn to master. That mastery is a form of worship. Therefore, the whole attempt at mastering your sense organs becomes a yaga. Why? Because you are looking at it as an offering. The fire is mastery, the sense organs are offered. What you are trying to do is do some, yeah, pratyahara, etc., can be said as the same thing. Yeah. So, what are you trying to do? You are trying to diet and lose weight, that's all. You are trying to diet and lose weight, but you are converting it into a worship, samyama agni, mastery. So, a time will come. What is the first thing you do when you are on a diet? Don't keep any sweets in the house, don't keep any palahara in the house. Don't keep any nashta in the house. It's easier then. No. But in my house is all there. Some dabba will always be there. Something, some chocolate will always be there in the fridge. Why? People come and I offer something. My Savanji, you have a sweet tooth. I don't have a sweet tooth. I have 32 sweet teeth. Then, so what's the problem? Let it be there, no? The mastery becomes natural. After some time, the mastery is natural. Yeah. Nice one, Sravani. Yeah. The mastery is natural after that. Not that you can't enjoy, but you know when to and when not to. Then the next verse is reverse. Shabdadin vishyan anyaha indriyagnu agnishu juhvati. Indriya Agni. Now the fire is Indriyas, your sense organs. Previously, control was the sense organ, Samyama. Now, the Indriyas themselves are the fire. What are you offering into it? nice things to see, nice smells, nice things to eat, taste, etc. So the very act of eating, smelling, etc. is looked upon as a yaga. That means, Swamiji, I prefer the second one because I can keep on doing yaga, keep on offering. No, if you look at it as a worship, you will not abuse it. You will not keep on dumping everything into the fire. You will dump, you will offer only what is meant to be offered to the fire. Therefore, some discipline will come in automatically there also. Therefore, mastery is a yaga. The ability to enjoy is another yaga. Because if you can't enjoy, if you start fearing food, if you start hating food, oh my God, you have a problem, big problem, psychological problem on your hands. Therefore, both together, what does it happen here? Sarvani indriya karmani, prana karmani chapare, atma samyoga agno, jukhati jnana deepite. Say sarva karmani. All karmani by your indriyas, sense organs as well as organs of action, everything. Prana karmani, your prana, the pranic activities, the energy body activities, etc. Chapare. Atma samyoga agno, in the self mastery. Jukhati is offered. What type of self mastery? Jnana deepite, where the fire of knowledge has been lit. With the self knowledge, there is a natural mastery that comes in, effortless mastery that comes in. Why? You are no more looking for ananda out there. Therefore, everything, there is a natural self mastery. What was discipline before you gain the knowledge becomes an ornament for you right now. So in that natural mastery, every activity is offered. Your whole life becomes a yaga. Sitting, walking, talking, smelling, breathing, eating, everything is a yaga. That is why the language means the sadhu is eating, it's a bhikshaghara. When he is sleeping, it's a samadhi. Why? Everything is converted to a yaga. What is that verse in the Manasa Puja, end of the Shiva Manasa Puja? There is a verse. Atma Tvam Girija Matihi. You are the Atma. Girija Parvati is the mind. Sahacharaha Prana. My pranas are all the Shiva Ganas. Nidra Samadhi Stiti. Then Pradakshana. My moving about is Pradakshana, etc. All activity sambhota varadhanam. This becomes natural with wisdom. It's a natural state to be. Aram Sir. Whole life is a yaga. And that is what has to be known. When you know yourself, everything is sacred, everything is apparent. Everything is sacred, everything is apparent. That's why in Rishikesh, you will never ask a sadhu, where do you stay? Maharaji, ab rehte kahan hai? You never ask. That's a wrong way of asking. You should understand the Rishikesh languages. It has got a beauty about it. It's funny also, okay? I can joke about it, but I can respect it also. You'll never ask, where do you stay? Maharaji, aapke asan kahan hai? Asan meaning, where is your seat of meditation? Where have you kept your seat of meditation? Yeah. Because aap to dhyana nishtha mahatma hu. Yeah. You are a contemplative soul. Aapke asan kahan hai? Not where are you staying. Where are you staying means, arre pura duniya. Sudesho bhunatrayam. So that attitude, that if you have that attitude, it's beautiful. Otherwise, it just becomes a joke. Okay, ab kya asan kahan hai? Where do you stay? No, where have you kept your meditation seat? Why? Because whole life is a yoga. Naturally, without effort. This is effortlessness. This is done effortlessly. When you're doing it as a sadhana, then you're being a karma yogi. Ishwara arpanam, prasada buddhi, etc. Then it becomes, then you can, that way you can convert everything that you do. Like, he showed two things. He will show more. Okay. And the next verse. Okay. Dravya yajnaha, tapo yajnaha, yoga yajnaha, tatapare. स्वाध्याय ज्ञान यज्ञश्च यतयः संशति संशितव्रताः द्रव्य यज्ञ द यागा दैट यू डू विथ मटेरियल्स द प्रॉपर यागा दैट यू सी इन दिस टेंपल्स एंड ऑल दैट थिंग द्रव्य यज्ञ देन तपो यज्ञ माय तपस इटसेल्फ इज अ यज्ञ और द्रव्य यज्ञ कैन मीन If I'm sharing my wealth, hey, COVID times, there are so many jobless people that I know. Share my wealth with them, whatever little I have, I will go and give it, I'll share it with people. Your dhobi, your maid, all of them. Like my dhobi has come back. I've asked the society to allow him to start coming, etc. The society said, give us a day or two, over the weekend we'll decide that. Everything has to be a big committee decision, no? Idiotic. Yeah. In the meantime, I asked him, what about you? You're staying here. Dal chawal sabhai ke ne? Samajhi, Babaji, lene ka hai sab. Okay, here. Give him some money. So let him set up something. Dravya yajna. Why? Into the fire of his need, you're offering your dravya, the material that you have. Narayana is a giver, Narayana is a receiver, not you. Dravya yajna, tapo yajna, tapas is the yajna. And you do tapas, now nobody does tapas. But any intense activity, okay? Any intense activity can be called as tapas. Meditation is tapas. And not 15 minutes morning, evening, okay? No. That doesn't make it tapas. 3 hours. Then tapas. Pranayama is tapas. When you're standing under the fan in an AC room and doing the pranayama and your sweat is pouring out of your body. That is the intensity. Then it becomes tapas. After that, you have to go and drink a lot of water and put some ice, etc. on your head. Otherwise, you get a splitting headache. That is tapas. Therefore, tapas is intense. Okay, don't tell me I do 15 minutes pranayama every day. Therefore, I am doing tapas. That's not tapas. There are some people in the class here, couple of people at least, attending today, who had learned some of those advanced pranayamas. Okay, they are not doing it regularly. I know that some one or two is, others are not. Some of you 1.5 hours. At the end of it, I'm drenched in sweat. Correct. That is tapas. Tapo yajna, tata pare adaju. Tapas as a yajna. Yeah, fasting is tapas. Yes. Not missing one meal. 3-4 days karlo, fir tapas ho jayega. Swadhyaya yajna. Swadhyaya is also a yajna. Swadhyaya is a yajna. When Swadhyaya is not, when you learn to chant your own Veda, okay, every one of us belongs to some Veda or the other, okay, that you will know from your Gotra, etc., which Veda you follow, which Rishi you follow. If you don't have that, okay, if you take yourself as my student, you can say, okay, we belong to the Sringeri and Kanchi Paramparas, therefore, the Shukla Yajurveda, the Krishna Yajurveda, these are Veda. Therefore, I learned to chant the whole Veda. There's another tapas, स्वाध्याय यज्ञ स्वाध्याय यज्ञ बिकॉज व्हाट इज यज्ञ ओके स्वाध्याय यज्ञ आई कम टू दैट देन यतय संशित व्रत विथ सम रूल्स एंड डिसिप्लिन्स एक्सेट्रा व्हेन यू डू इट बिकम्स ए यज्ञ व्हाट वी आर डूइंग नाउ इज ऑल्सो यज्ञ into the fire of knowledge you are offering your ignorance you are offering your notions yeah it looks like the teacher is doing it it will become a yajna for the students when the student offer their notions into the fire of knowledge not hold on to the notions and justify it no no Swamiji said it from that standpoint from this standpoint I am okay they not offered not offered into the fire of knowledge when you offer your ignorance when you offer your notions when you offer your ideas etc and then let it come let those notions and ideas be purified in the fire of knowledge that is another yajna jnana yajna it is called jnana yajna so all this okay so why is he talking in terms of a yajna now why because he is keeping the karma yogi in mind What is it that you want to do? What is your main discipline in life? Take one discipline and do it. One discipline and do it. Any one discipline will help you. You know, when we do all this energy work, yeah. One breath. Do just one breathing. One inhalation, one exhalation. But how is it done? It should take 4 minutes. One. You do only 9 breaths in a day. Bas ho gaya. One inhalation, exhalation, 4 minutes, 5 minutes. So 9 breaths will take you 45 minutes of practice. It'll make your life. You will get the discipline, the will, etc. That is what is necessary in life, isn't it? So the idea here is, whatever activity you are attracted to, you may not be attracted to born up as very secular setup that we are to a proper worship, etc. All right, do this. Krishna is very broad. He says, convert any activity that you like into a yaga. So that Ishwar Arpanam and Prasada Buddhi comes into your life very naturally, very spontaneously. That is the idea. One, a sense of discipline, a sense of mastery comes in. And secondly, the Bhakti Bhava of Ishwar Arpanam and Prasada Buddhi. Bhakti has to convert itself into this. Bhakti is an emotion born of recognition of Ishwara. Therefore, that Ishwara's order you see everywhere in this. For that, to get that emotion out, you may need an activity. Pick up what you like. He's not completed it. There are more. Okay, there are more here coming in. Okay, yeah. So we'll see that over this thing. Next couple of classes, we'll see all of them. But the idea is this: that you convert everything. You use one discipline to get that attitude into you, and then extend it to all your life. Because really speaking on the mature mind, you need two things. One is a sense of mastery and the other is letting go. What is yours, nothing is yours, it's all Ishwara's. And second, mastery. Body, mind, etc. will listen to what you do. If this is there, there's nothing you can't achieve. That is the whole learning. That's why all the sadhanas, etc., are meant really speaking for learning this. Clear up to now? think it over, and next class we will see more of this. Okay, good place to stop. Om Tat Sat. Murder is predestined. I don't know who is saying that. No murder is predestined. Yeah, murder is an abuse of will. Yeah. Okay, a good place to stop. Any questions? Ask next time. Om Tat Sat.